Attention all you Amtrak customers waiting to get moving again on Amtrak number 19. The Crescent Line with service to New Orleans and Louisiana. Once again, we apologize for the delays we are experiencing on account of the weather. Looks like we're still going to be delayed at least another hour. I'll give you any updates just as soon as I have them, and we'll get you all on your way. Thank you for riding Amtrak.
The number 19 Crescent Line.
That train been delayed by weather.
Did the station master happen to mention how long they thought it might be?
Well, he said at least an hour, but then there's the weather.
Yeah. Well, I've been waiting most all my life to get where I'm going. Reckon I can wait another hour to get there. Reckon we all gotta wait a while anyways. I do apologize for bothering you. I didn't mean to sound so anxious. It's just that I need to get myself so much urgently down to Gilly Bend, Alabama, on account of the visitation and all. You see, I've been having these. Now, where are my manners? I haven't yet introduced you to my traveling companion. This is Miss Isabella Rainsong. Isn't she a thing of beauty? You think she's a looker? Just wait till you hear how she sounds. Miss Isabella says she's very pleased to make your acquaintance. I never get tired of hearing this Rainsong sing. Me and Miss Rainsong, we've been singing and riding rails together for about 3 years now. We've been back and forth across the continent, up and down both coasts more times than I can count. No particular destination in mind, just riding. You know, riding on a train, it ain't like riding in a car. In a car, you're looking straight ahead. You can see what's coming. On a train, you're just looking out the side like you're watching a movie where the world slowly passes you by. It's like you're on the outside looking in, not a part of anything. It's like you're living on the edge of the world. Living on the edge gives a sense of direction, the final destination for a wandering soul. Living on the edge leads to deep introspection, wants to get you started, you spin out of control. Living on the edge, you tend to lose your sense of mission. What used to look so dangerous now seems to be fine. Living on the edge is a precarious position, just a little step, you've crossed over the line of the edge. Edge of the world. Living on the edge gives a different point of view. You can see things clearly if you see them at all. Helps you keep the space between the old and the new, the things you can't remember and the things you recall. Living on the edge, you catch a glimpse of forever. Makes you wonder what's on the other side. Looking over the edge is a futile endeavor. There's nothing really there, so there's nothing to hide on the other side. On the edge of the world, you can see the rainbow's end. out your hand and touch a shooting star. You can lift up your eyes and see across the universe and know who you are, who you are. Traffic or passers-by. It's the end of the line, the last scene of the show. There's no turning back, there ain't nowhere to go. Ready or not, dead or alive, you're already there by the time you arrive. It's just the luck of the draw, the roll of the dice. It's got nothing to do with who's been naughty or nice. It's the end of all time, or the time for all ends, and the best you can do is keep. On the edge of the world, on the edge of the world. Association. On the first matter of possession, Miss Isabella Rainsong is in no way possessed by the likes of me, or by the likes of anyone else for that matter. In truth, it's closer to being the other way around, that she is the possessor and I the possessed. Instead, perhaps the best way to describe our admittedly unique relationship is to say that she and I are traveling companions. On the second matter of me being a scallywag, well, that impression is more or less true. That is, if you're in the mindset that once a scallywag, always a scallywag. I like to think of myself as a reformed scallywag. But over the course of my life, I've done more than enough in the scallywag department to have qualified for a lifetime membership of the Scallywags of America Club. That much is for certain. I do, however, appreciate any charitable notions you may have in allowing me the benefit of the doubt that despite appearances to the contrary, I'm in fact a scallywag of the reformed sort. I venture to say that this Rainsong here has been fully responsible for my reformation. Through the music she's brought to me and the people we've met through that music, we must have written a gazillion songs together. Well, she wrote them and I was the transcriptionist or something like that. I really have no idea. You know, we even have a song about what this whole song transcribing experience feels like. This particular song will be a little easier for you to understand if you know these two little random factoids that she and I learned on our journey together. Factoid number one, most songs you hear on the radio are about 3.5 minutes long, which is the same as 210 seconds if I got my arithmetic right. Factoid number two, something we learned from a doctor, a surgeon, when she was telling us some stories about things she'd seen in the operating room. She mentioned that all the scalpels and sutures have numbers with them, like a number 10 blade scalpel. Well, you take two factoids and you add them together and you get a metaphor wrapped up in a song. This song is about a number 210 scalpel. It's the length of a song, but twice as sharp, and it pretty much describes what my experience with this Rainsong has been like. slice down the middle. She says, sit tight, this is gonna hurt a little. With a rip-racking chorus and retracting refrain, a local anesthesia barely touches the pain. Tumor's exposed, but it can't be excised. The cancer runs deep, it's metastasized. The surgeon sees the fear in her patient's eyes. Just 3 minutes, 30 seconds, the procedure's through. The surgeon shakes her head and leaves, nothing more to do. Why cry the patient? Tell me why you have to prep instead of letting me be. Now I'm condemned to misery. That number 210 scalpel got the best of me. His weary eyes by the chalk by the bed, replacing all the vital signs, a line of notes instead. And then he reads, so many broken souls are only fallow ground. Vibrations in their ears, all they hear is sound. But the open soul resonates with every tone. You finish each line like it's already known. Claim it for your own. And now your soul is chiming in. You didn't write the song, the surgeon doesn't force a steal. But in the surgeon's hand, the scalpel can heal. It's a lifelong procedure attempted by few. But take another look and you'll see.
Separate you from your hard-earned money through some wild scheme of my own invention. I swear by everything good on this earth that what I'm telling you is what really happened, as best as I understand it, and that I'm just as dumbfounded by the whole experience as you are likely to be once I tell you the truth of it. That is, if you're even interested in hearing about it. Here I go yammering on without even bothering to ask you if you got something you'd rather be doing. Like sticking your nose in one of them electronic gizmos everybody seems to be carrying around these days. Well, there's no more to life than what you can fit in a little TV box the size of your palm. You know, doing all that snapbook and insta-chat stuff all day long. Instead of lifting your head up every once in a while and seeing what's happening in the real world. Like this couple I saw a while back. They sat in a cafe car across from me. Each one working on their laptop and talking on their cell phone, doing important stuff, no doubt. Neither one paying one lick of attention to the other. After watching them for about 5 hours straight, the fella two finally lifts his head up long enough to notice me and his Rainsong. He tells me they're on a romantic weekend getaway together. I just smiled and started singing. Hit the snooze button, honey, doesn't matter, rain or sunny, I don't care if the sky is blue or green. Got no doubt if we could find a dozen reasons to grind another work a day, day through the mission machine. We never lack for excuses, and the race we run, we hit the track and take cruises, but we never get done. Our agenda's on a bender, it's demanding us surrender, and we're claiming that there's no other way. But even if it's I say, not today. No, baby, not today. Not today. Well, drop that newspaper, baby. It'll make us both crazy trying to follow all the tragedy in politics. Sure, we need a good solution for tsunamis and pollution, but they're gonna have to wait another day for a fix. Right now, my only worry is the whistling pot telling me it's time to brew my baby something hot. And when the sun is finally slipping into something more befitting for a walk along the beach by the bay, we'll find some time to find a way, but not today. Oh, baby, not today. Cause today we're getting down to what we never get around to. Our to-dos will be infused by the time for me and you. We can't wait another day, or let the hours waste away. So hurry up and turn it down without delay. My love, cause we've had more than enough of all that stuff they call reality on TV. The only thing I know for real is your Buddha's smile and the way they make me feel when it shines a while. Though I suppose in some scenario you could decide it's time to go, and as you turn to walk away, I'll turn your back gently to say, not today. Oh baby, not today. Help me and sort this whole thing out, say it out loud, so you all can hear and judge for yourself whether I'm a nutcase or a fool, or whether I'm doing exactly what I'm supposed to do. Seems like we got time anyway. So how about if I just start from the start and see if we can't get all caught up to the here and now? Would that be all right with all y'all? All right then. I'm much obliged. So, for the purposes of getting to the parts that matter most, let's just agree here and now that the life I lived up to a point about 3 years ago didn't amount to a hill of beans. Less than that, even. I'd say if there was anybody on this earth who had done less of anything to be of use to himself or others, you'd be hard-pressed to find him. I lied, cheated, and abused my way through pretty much everyone who ever crossed my path. I don't reckon there's a single soul who would have mourned my passing back then, including me. The day everything changed was in a train station a whole lot like this one. The night I walked into that station, I was on the run from one thing to another. I didn't have a dime to my name. And I didn't care if I jumped onto the next train leaving town or jumped out in front of it. And frankly, I didn't give a damn one way or the other. Pardon my French, man. The place was dead quiet. Not a soul in it that I could see. Just one train was coming through that night. Sort of makes it hard to slip onto a passenger train unnoticed when you were the only one getting on. So at that point, the odds were decidedly in favor of my head becoming an Amtrak hood ornament within the hour. It was as dark a moment in my life as I ever hoped to have. Right about then, the station master comes on the announcement of the PA, saying, "Hum, hum, 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 hum." I sort of lost in my own thoughts, so I didn't pay him no never mind. A couple minutes go by, and he's on again. "Would the traveling companion of Miss Isabella Rainsong please meet her in front of the information booth?" I finally clued into what he was saying and realized I was standing right at the information booth. And like I said, there wasn't anybody in the place. You understand, I wasn't exactly in a socializing sort of mood, so I figured I would make myself scarce before Miss What's-Her-Name's friends come strolling along. I walk around the information booth and BAM! Go find that silver tea kettle. Tell the truth. First time I laid eyes on her, I wasn't even sure what I was looking at. I didn't know thing one about musical instruments or music at all for that matter, but this creature in front of me was prettier than anything I'd ever seen. Her all black body, so polished. It's like you could see the whole world reflected in her shine. I was mesmerized just looking at her. That first touch was like a first kiss. I swear, it's like she plugged herself into my spine and sent electricity to all my fingers and toes. I'd never felt anything like it before, and I'm telling you, it took my breath away. I still feel it now. Not quite as intense as that first time, but it still feels amazing to hold Miss Rainsong in my arms. Like embracing a black hole of sunshine or black light, warm and cool at the same time. I feel her pull every molecule of my being into her, and she warms me in return. I'm not really sure how long I sat there on the floor with Miss Rainsong cradled in my arms. It was a station master who broke the spell. I see these big old black work shoes step up to me where I'm sitting there on the floor, and I'm sure I've been busted. He just stands there for the longest time before he finally says, "Sir, if you're taking this train to St. Louis, you best get yourself and your lover there onto the platform. They'll be here in about 2 minutes." I didn't say nothing, and he walked off. Of course, I had no money and no ticket to buy, no money to buy one with, so I'm starting to panic a little, because I'm sure he's got his eyes on me since I'm the only one in the place. That's about the time I noticed the envelope. stuck up on the top there with this little clip. Found out later they call this thing a capo, like the bite off my nose. So I take a peek inside. There's a letter. I pull it out. Open it up. Hello, traveler. My name is Miss Isabella Rainsong. I'm very pleased to make your acquaintance. Over the years of riding these rails across this fine land of ours, I have found the journey much more pleasurable when shared with a companion. Don't you agree? Well, I can tell you for certain that at the time anyway, I most definitely did not agree with the notion of having a travel companion. For me, traveling usually took the form of skipping town in the middle of the night like I had been that night. Such modes of transit are generally solo affairs that are loath to be weighted down with such things as companions and belongings. So I'm mulling over this strange note, put it back in the envelope, when I notice it contains something else. A ticket. This ticket entitles its bearer and one traveling companion unlimited coach class passage on the Amtrak rail system throughout the continental United States of America. That's it. No restrictions, no expiration date. It looked real enough, printed up all fancy. But I couldn't imagine it was actually a bona fide ticket, more like a souvenir or something. Still, I figured it'd at least be good enough to get me onto the train before they was on to me. By that time, we'd be on our way. Sure enough, more than nothing at all, hopping on the train, station master doesn't say boo to me as I walk by him on the platform. Seems like the train barely came to a stop as I boarded. Lickety-split, we was on our way. So now, they'd have to drop me off at the next stop once they saw my bogus ticket, which was fine by me because I already had a plan in mind, and that plan was pawn shop. This guitar must be worth a little something. Figured I could at least get enough for a decent meal and a bottle of Troubles Be Gone from the liquor store. I tell you what, it pains my heart to admit I ever carried such a thought in my mind, even for a minute. Well, that whole notion blew right on by when the conductor steps into my car. This scowling rickety man starts clickety-clacking his little hole puncher like it's making the train go. But he seemed to need to make a big production out of making sure everybody was accounted for. He's halfway down to my row in the middle of the car, and already I can feel my heart pounding like it's going to pop right out of my chest. Now, you have to appreciate that by this point in my life, I had elevated the bold-faced lie to a fine art and was in the habit of making stuff up on the fly for no other purpose than to exercise my craft. Could look you straight in the eye and say that I had made my first million before I turned 25 and was starting up a brand new can't miss venture, or that I was a traveling preacher, glory to God, who was on a mission to save starving children in Inner Mongolia and have you believe in every word and put that in the checkbook. Let's just agree that I was not unaccustomed to having property of ambiguous ownership in my possession. So, it was very uncharacteristic of me to be breaking a sweat over this little finest keeper situation. This fella coming up the aisle didn't know me from Adam, but I thought he was going to take one look at my sorry self and punch me full of holes with that little ticket thing of his. And every step closer he took made me shake. By the time he gets to my row, I'm ready to confess every awful thing I'd ever done, and even ones I hadn't. And I'm completely mystified about what's getting under my craw, so, which just served to add to my general state of agitation. He stares me down with them watery hoot-owl eyes of his. Ticket! I can barely breathe, and I'm shaking so hard, I dropped the envelope that's got the ticket in it, had to go fishing for it on the floor, and in the doing of it, knocked Miss Rainsong clean off her seat. Let me tell you what, you never seen an old geezer move so fast. Quick as a flash, he grabs hold of her, sets her aright. And the look he gave me could have bored two holes straight through my skull cleaner than he could have done with that puncher of his. Chicken! So it was with some degree of trepidation that I pulled my ticket out of the envelope and handed it over. He never takes his eyes off me the whole time. Holds it in his arm, holds it in his hands. This would be your first use of the ticket. Instead of more like a statement than a question. I try to respond, my mouth's so dry, nothing's coming out, so I just nod. Still staring at me, he lifts the ticket up in one hand and his puncher in the other. He punches a hole in the air and hands the untouched ticket back to me. Hoof! Now with that, he turns on his heels and heads down to the next car, not even bothering to check anybody else's tickets. And just as he gets to that pass-through door, he says, "She prefers a window seat," and walks out. Well, that was it for me. By that point, I was on full tilt. Felt like I was in some sort of Twilight Zone episode where everybody's in on the joke but me. Maybe in telling it to you, it doesn't sound all that strange to you, but the whole thing was way too otherworldly for me. Like the spooky bejesus out of me. I was getting off that train even if it meant jumping off. I had to move Miss Rainsong to get to the aisle. I grabbed her by the neck. Dang it! Got stuck with one of them string tips. This one little speck of blood shows up on my thumb. I watch it grow, and after a spell, it turns into a drop. And as I'm looking at that drop, it's like I can see inside it. And deep inside are a bunch of little images of my life. Pictures from 1,000 dark moments. Hurts done to me and hurts done by me. All mixed together. That one drop of blood falls off my thumb and right into Miss Spring Song's sound hole and deep into her black heart. I started feeling woozy all of a sudden. Had to sit myself back down. In another minute, I was out cold. Somewhere during that death's doorstep sleep, I had a dream. So vivid, even now, it's like I can see it in my mind's eye. I'm standing at the entrance to the county fairground. A stone's throw from where I grew up. There's a banner where the carnival used to come through every summer. Except the whole place is empty. But for one attraction. Carnival Barker calls across the field, come try your luck, come spin the wheel, spin the wheel, spin the wheel, ain't a better deal, play the get a life, the get a life lottery. Step right up, give it a spin, trade your tired life for a brand new skin. You could be the Queen of Sheba with the Nobel Prize, be a famous supermodel, see your fortunes rise, be a great tribal leader on the African plain. Just think about all you could gain, but you gotta spin the wheel, spin the wheel, spin the wheel, and a better deal. The get a life lottery. I check out that ticket in the palm of my hand. Keep this lackluster
the life, I find the promised land. I step up to the marker, take a deep breath, trade my ticket with the barker for a happier death, and spin the wheel. I spin the wheel.
Friendly gaze or the open-handed gesture. But I say,
sat myself down across from him. The call comes back with the water and some coffee, too, and said, "You're the black you could do in the pick-me-up." He sits himself right down next to me. So now I'm trapped and I can feel my blood pressure rising. I manage to thank him for gulping down the water. Then Grizzly offers me a piece of his wife's world-famous coffee cake. When I decline, he says, "Come on now, you know you're starving. Think I'd steer you wrong? Look at me and say I don't know a thing or two about coffee cake." Carl says, "Shit, coffee cake? Any cake, pies, cookies, pudding. Maybe here could sniff out the best hole-in-the-wall for dessert 100 miles from the nearest stop." So, you're pretty much obligated to have some, seeing that they're trapped in there. I say I'll have a bite. And I proceed to scoff down the entire pan before I even take a breath. They just keep looking at me and offering me more coffee and some orange slices and beef jerky and ham sandwich. And I wolf it all down like I'm some lost orphan child or something. When I'm finally finished eating, I feel like a fool for doing that in front of them. And they just keep smiling at me all motherly and all. That's about the time my bladder chimes in to remind me that I've transitioned from gonna pee to gotta pee. I started to excuse myself, and Grizzly just sets me right back down and starts into, leans way over, takes a good long gander, starts laughing to himself. "Carl, would you say that each new traveler seems even more lost than the last one?"
"I sure would, baby. I sure would."
"Son, you have any idea what you're in for?" "No, sir. I just came to get some water and use the facilities. Now, if you'll..." "Yeah, just a minute now. Aren't you just the least bit curious about your travel companion?" "I'm sorry, sir. Mister, you must got me confused with somebody else. I'm by myself."
"You mean you're not with Miss Rainsong?"
"Huh? What? Wait, there. You talk about that guitar? No. That guitar don't belong to me. I'm just watching out for its rightful owner."
"Young man, Miss Isabella Rainsong don't have no owner. As I recall, slavery was abolished in this country under the Lincoln administration. What you are is Miss Rainsong's traveling companion." "I have no idea what you're talking about, but I gotta go right now." And I jumped right out of that booth, right over the table, and made a beeline for the bathroom.
Grizzly yells out, "Suit yourself, but next time you need some help, just ask one of us old geezers. We won't bite, I promise." I bust into that restroom line, ready to bust myself. But relief is just a moment away, so... Any of you fellas out there know what stage fright is? You know, the men's room kind where you're up in the line with all the guys in the room and you just can't bring yourself to, you know, let it go, even no matter how bad you gotta go. Well, there's this spot in your brain, I guess, that's in charge of deciding when the coast is clear and you can relax enough to, you know, take a leak. Y'all with me, right? Right? So, turns out that brain spot is what you might call obstinate, because once the decider makes up its mind to open up the floodgates, you can't tell it otherwise, no matter how hard you might try. So as soon as I slid that door closed, the whistle blew, and all them muscles I've been working for the last half hour went out for a smoke break. But relief was just a foot away in the form of a beautiful stainless steel bowl. So why? But I'll be damned if I can't get my buttons undone. It's like I got frostbite or something. I'm trying like that, and the jeans I'm wearing are really tight. I can't even shimmy them down. I'm yelling, "Stop the presses! Hold your fire! Houston, we have a problem!" And that damn brain spot just keeps going full steam ahead. You know, if you've been drunken, drugged out, loser as long as I had, you'd have found yourself sleeping in your own piss and vomit plenty of times. The thing is, in your mind, you blame everybody but somebody who is to blame, like somebody else came along and pissed and hurled all over you. So, as I look down and watch my faded jeans turn a dark blue, all I felt was shame. a deep, abiding shame. And for the first time in God knows how long, I started into crying. And once I started into crying, I just couldn't stop. I must have been in there about 10 minutes when there's a knock on the door and Risley's voice saying,
"Everything all right in there, son?"
I hear him jangling his keys as he unlocks the door and slides it open. I feel his big hand on my shoulder. I finally lift my head up to see my sorry side of myself in the mirror. Stinking, strung out, and looking like death warmed over.
Take a good long look, son.
Where you're standing right now
is rock bottom. Things will get better from here. I can promise you that. This Rainsong will take care of your soul. Me and the boys will take care of the rest. All you gotta do is go along for the ride and keep yourself open to the experience. You think you can handle that?
I didn't think I even had enough in me to take another breath, let alone live another day. I managed to exhale something approximating a moan. Grizzly said,
"I'll take that as a yes. Now we're about to pull into the station. You stay here and splash some water on your face. Carl will get Miss Rainsong for you, and we'll take you out to meet Mr. Jenkins, the station master. He'll get you set up a place to rest up and clean up for a while before you get on your way."
As he steps out to leave me alone with my miserable self of a human being, he says,
"You know,
picking up Miss Rainsong and that ticket, it's kind of like winning the lottery, son. So how's it feel being the luckiest man alive?" It was as though he had known about that carnival dream I had the night before. I stood there alone, shaking like a newborn cow, and feeling about as far from being the luckiest man alive as Tuscaloosa is from Timbuktu. But somewhere, deep in my soul, buried so deep I didn't even know it was there, somehow, it spoke to me, it resonated with me. And despite every piece of evidence to the contrary, I knew he was right. And I just had to let go and give in to whatever was happening to me. And the first time in my life, I felt an entirely new emotion. One I can only describe as, "What do you got to lose, hope?" Can it be true? Can it really be you? You who's come to save me. Save me from me. Is there a chance? Could it be this circumstance has the power to unchain me and set me free? Could it be? Do I dare believe there is anything inside me worth pulling from the flame? Can you see something I can't see in me? Something I'm supposed to be? A future I could claim? It can't be true. Could it be true? Will it be true? I guess I'll have to trust you.
Attention, all you Amtrak customers waiting to get moving again on Amtrak number 19. This storm seems to be just sitting between us and Birmingham, and there have been tornado sightings along the route. All we got up here is heavy rain, but the weather service is saying that we ought to just sit tight. So I suggest ourselves comfortable and settled in for a wait. Our coffee maker's busted right now, but the water fountain puts out as good a water as you'll find in your bottles and your vending machine, and there's respectable coffee at the bus stop just up the road if you really need it. But I warn you, it's pretty nasty out there. In any case, don't go wandering off too far. Thank you for riding Amtrak.
Well, now, I guess between recounting that darkest of days and all the station master talk of rain, coffee, water fountains, I gotta, let's just say that I've learned my lesson about not waiting too long to answer nature's call. If you don't mind, I'm gonna excuse myself for a minute. When I come back, I can tell you what happened next. That is, if y'all want to listen.
Station master pointed me to a place to wash up, and
When I got out, there'd be a clean set of clothes there waiting for me. It wasn't like some big mysterious thing, either. More like part of the logistics of making the trains go. You know, it was somebody's job to fill up the paper towel dispensers whenever they needed it in the train's restrooms, and somebody else's job to leave a clean set of clothes for me whenever I stopped in for a shower. Most of them treated me about like you would a paper towel dispenser, too. Not particularly mean, but not nice, either. I was just one more part of the system they had to keep making sure worked, and that was that. So, besides eating and sleeping and getting a little exercise and wandering around the town to where we stopped, all I had to do was take care of this Rainsong. I did my best to keep her comfortable, you know, propped up in a window seat like she liked it. I just stared at her for hours on end, or just hold her sometimes. I know it sounds kind of creepy, but holding her made me feel better, more at peace. I also kind of acted like a celebrity bodyguard, you know, people coming on and off the train all the time, sometimes for short trips, other times for days on end. Most everybody who looked at Miss Rainsong was mesmerized by her, drawn to her even. Especially musicians would look at her and say how they'd never seen anything like her. Sometimes they'd ask me if they could play her, and I'd tell them no. Most would be respectful of that. And then this one fellow, about 2 months into this strange trip, kept pestering me about her, asking me questions I couldn't answer, like what she was made of and what she sounded like. When he asked me what kind of music I played and I said, I don't, he was, to say the least, incredulous. You mean to tell me you have this amazing instrument and you've never even played her? Not even once? I said, she's not for playing. So he actually starts getting angry with me and yelling, like he's gonna pull out a can of whoop-ass or something. We get into this strange game of keep away with him trying to get his hands on her strings so she can strum, and me trying to keep him as far away from his Rainsong as I can. One of the conductors finally had to jump in and send him off to another car under the threat of being ejected from the train as he's picking up his luggage and going off in a huff. After that, the conductor says to me,
she's right, you know. She needs to be played every day, just like a Jersey cow needs to be milked. She must be pretty heavy with song.
I know you're going to think I'm a total idiot when I tell you this, but right up to that very moment, the thought of playing this Rainsong, it never even crossed my mind. I never even wondered what she sounded like. To me, it would have been like strumming a suitcase or plucking a statue or something. I was so tied to her as a physical thing, the way she looked and felt in my arms. Like I said, I didn't know the first thing about guitars or music at all, for that matter. Music, for me, had never played any role in my life at all, other than being background noise that I just assumed not hear if I could help it. You could even say that I had sort of a bias against music, like I was a musical bigot or something. Fact is, I hadn't even sung a single note, as much as tapped out a beat with my fingers, since I was about 4 years old. One day, I come home from my next door neighbors. I was playing schoolhouse with one of my little friends, and his older sister, she taught us the ABC song. So I come home all proud of myself, singing real loud. My dad said I sounded like a howling alley cat, and a sick one at that. So I sang louder. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, go! You're gonna be a dickhead, you shut the fuck up! Still have a scar on my forehead from that little episode, courtesy of dear old dad, chucking his half full beer can right at my head. I'd show him, I thought. Next week at his birthday, I refused to sing the happy birthday song. Just to prove the point, I never sang again. Not a single note. After a while, I just sort of forgot all about what started it all. Right up until that very moment on the train, then it hit me right between the eyes. was episodes like that one, days like that, and other similar episodes involving my father, of which they were thankfully precious few on account of he wasn't exactly an involved parent. And I could see how they set me on a path to nowhere good. Of course, I had some good examples, too. You know, every once in a while, there'd be a teacher, or coach, or neighbor, who would sort of take me under their wing for a spell. I don't know why. Maybe because they saw what kind of predicament I was in at home. But they'd do what they could, and I'd inevitably disappoint them by acting up or doing something stupid and mean. I guess I was an angry kid. So, whenever I see someone on the train mistreating their kid, you know, lashing out at them or talking to them like they ain't even human beings, let alone their own flesh and blood, I do my best to point them in a different direction with a smile. Or a story, or a song. I like to think, maybe, I just make this little difference in little ones' lives, kind of like my teachers and coaches did for me, like when they helped me out, tossed me out of the nest, hope I could fly, never knowing whatever happened to me. Remember me? Probably not. I think about you quite a lot. Wondering how time has been treating you. All the big adventures you've been through. You needed a hand, I gave you a boost. Held you for a moment, then cut you loose. Sent you out into big bad world. Though the time we shared was just a moment or two. You're in my heart, and I wish for you. Green grass between your toes, cool drinks from the water hose. Fields of fireflies at night, lazy day summers and water gun fights. Candy canes and homemade pies, city songs and lullabies. But most of all, when I look to the stars above, baby child, I pray you find love. Years have passed, time's ticking away. Getting older day by day. Every year becomes a bigger unknown. So now every time you cross my mind, I send out a wish in hopes you'll find. Secrets only your best friend knows. Swapping notes in the back to rows, playing that piano piece just right. First kiss on a perfect night, scoring that last minute soccer goal. Homecoming dances at honor roll. And every time I look to the stars above, baby child, I pray to find love. Someday I hope you find someone to care for. Cause the best sort of wish is the kind that you pass on through. And you can wish someone green grass between your toes, cool drinks from the water hose, fields of fireflies at night, lazy day summers and water gun fights, candy canes and homemade pies, silly songs and lullabies. Most of all, when I look to the stars above, baby child, baby child, I pray you find love. see on the train or abuse their kids or something like that. I love seeing moms and dads introducing their little ones to the train. It's a huge adventure for them. What a way to see America. And I've seen all kinds of great examples of parents with their children. Like this one goofball of a guy whose little boy let out this totally infectious giggle every time his daddy did something fun. When the conductor comes by, the little boy says, "My daddy is the king of all the daddies." Made me smile, because that's the kind of daddy I hope to be someday. Since my early days, I've tried to find ways to fit in with the happening crew. But whatever my plot, cool I was not, didn't matter what I knew. I was always on the outside, every day just another blow to my pride. And to tell the truth, I was a total goof, it's true. That's for now, and I'll tell you how this big daddy came to rule. I was handed a son, but was nearly a nun by Sippy Cups, Doctors, and Pool. But as my boy began to grow, in time I came to know, to my surprise, in his eyes I'm cool. Because I can blow bubbles, and I can throw three balls. I can whip up a snack, let it ride on my back. I even let him scribble on the bathtub walls. I can laugh like Tigger, make a splash the fool. To the rest of the crowd, I ain't too proud to admit I play the fool. But to my son, I'm the king of fun, cause I'm a daddy kind of fool. Day, most every way we stick together like glue. And after his nap, when he's up on my lap, it's time to watch Winnie the Pooh. He thinks that I'm a rock star when he sees me strumming on my guitar. And we're happening cats when the Jungle Book scat like in Louie and Baloo. Hey! It's Bob Bob Moody. Holla, dee dee da 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 da. So what, I can't recall a single Beatles song. I can name every Wiggland, sing along. At least for a while, he's hip to my style. I'm as hip as they get with the tricycle set. I said to my son, I'm the king of fun, cause I'm a daddy kind of cool. I'm a daddy kind of cool. Ba-ba-da-da-da. Being all obsessed with wanting to know what Miss Rainsong sounded like, and what I sounded like for that matter. But I'm still not where I'm supposed to be here. Song for the first time on the train, something told me it was going to be a pretty important moment. So I got off the next stop, started walking until I could find a park. park or something where we could have some time alone. I ended up finding this cemetery way up on a hill overlooking the train yard where I could see everything. It was one of them glory days, you know, when the air is perfect and smells like sunshine and life, not too hot, not too cold. So lots of folks are out and about. I walked around the cemetery for a while and found this perfect spot for sitting way up on a, under a, the biggest and oldest tree in the place, where I could watch the trains come and go through the depot while I waited for folks to clear out. And then, when the time was just right, I took Miss Rainsong in my arms and the best way I could figure out the right way to hold her. As much as I had been moved the first time I laid eyes on her, hearing Miss Rainsong's voice completely did me in. I just kept strumming on her, like we was making love or something. Me, the total novice who didn't know the first thing about the music version of lovemaking, Miss Rainsong, the one who knows everything there is to know in this song. She showed me where to go and what to do, like a patient lover. We just made music all night long, repeating sounds and patterns that sounded right.
Foibles.
In my Neverland dream, love reigns supreme, and every lost hope gets its own second chance. It could happen if we all join the dance. And it's 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, gliding so easily, floating like Fred Astaire, lighter than air. And it's left side closed, back side closed, round and round so it goes, filling the room with enchanting.
This old hillbilly dance around that tree all night long. But that was the night. That night was the night my dance with Miss Rainsong really began. I mean, before, taking care of Miss Rainsong was a job. Not a chore exactly, because it wasn't particularly hard. But now was all I could do to keep my hands off of. We sat belly to back most all the time. Even at night when I was laid out on one of row of seats, she'd be in my arms. I'd polish her with this little shammy rag that I got from one of the engineers. And whenever I wasn't polishing her, I was learning more about playing her. Or, as she likes to say, singing with her. You know, because she's got a voice just like you and me, only we only got two vocal cords. Miss Rainsong's got six. You know, so like I said, you know, people were drawn to Miss Rainsong, but once I started playing her, I mean, it was like moths to a flame, like they had to be near her, close to her, and they'd start talking to me, kind of like you talk to somebody through an interpreter, you know? Because really, they was talking to her. And not just like idle chit-chat sort of how's the weather sort of stuff. No, they were pouring out their souls and telling their life stories and asking her for advice. It's kind of hard to explain because it's not like they would just walk up and start talking to her like she was a real person or something. But I typically set up shop in the cafe car. And the conductors were less antsy about me making music there. I'd jokes, noodle on this or that, they come like, looks like a pot papa or something. They just come wandering in. You know, usually they'd start off. There we go. It's like you got your underwear a little in the right place. You know, she likes it when she's into. But, you know, usually they'd start off saying something about how amazing she was, but it wasn't ever too long before they'd start talking about, you know, spilling their guts out, and I'd be right there listening. So after a while, I'd start playing a tune that sounded like what they was talking about, you know, just sort of fit the mood. But after a while more, I'd start listening to what Miss Rainsong was sounding, saying back, and try to find the human words for what she was saying. Songs would just come out. Sort of rough at first, but sometimes just out. And like I said, most people were drawn to her, but not everybody. Some folks were, you know, just too numb. You know, they were too busy in their own stuff or working or just their own things, and it's really a shame. And then there was this one woman. Man, she was neither drawn nor numb to Miss Rainsong. She seemed transfixed on her. But more like somebody who comes upon some horrific accident and just, you know, can't look away. And the longer she looked, the longer her face got. It took a while. But I finally got her to tell me her story. Annie Mae, look and see, Tammy rushes in to tell her, you won't believe it, I was calling number 43, front row seats, limousine, a full-size color poster, I can't believe it, this is really happening to me, it's like a dream we finally get to hear, the country entertainer of the year, but there is something Tammy doesn't know. Annie Mae was with him back when he was just an average Joe. She used to be his inspiration. Every song was a love note just for her. They shared their dreams when dreams were all they had. Now he's finally made his move up to the big time. He reached the moon, but he left her back behind. Now she's just a fan in the crowd. Long ago, far away, they hit the road together. They lived on tips and dreams while he worked the music scene. She'd sit back so she could hear him play and pour his heart out on the music stage. He'd sing to her like no one else was there. If people saw their love, she didn't care. She used to be his inspiration. Every song was a love note just for her. They shared their dreams when dreams were all they had. Now he's finally made his move up to the big time. He reached the moon, but he left her back behind. Now another fan in the crowd. He takes the stage and from the screaming crowd it's plain to see this country superstar is every woman's fantasy. They shout his name together as the house lights dim. They would give anything to be with him. Final song, single spot, he sings a tender ballad, just him and his guitar, like those days so long ago. Suddenly he sees her in the crowd, he stops his song and calls her name out loud. He sings to her like no one else is there. If people see their love, she doesn't care. Annie Mae.
You all right? You're in a trance or something? The concert's over. The limo's here to take us home. A single tear falls down on Annie's cheek. She barely whispers as she tries to speak. I have to tell you something you don't know. We were together back when he was just an average Joe. I used to be his inspiration. Every song was a love note just for me. We shared our dreams when dreams were all we had. And now he's finally made us move up to the big time. He reached the moon, but he left me back behind. Now I'm just another fan in the crowd. She used to be his inspiration, but now she's just another fan in the crowd.
Professor, a scientist or something, who was doing all this research about the chemistry of love. Not like metaphorical chemistry, like they had great chemistry together. I mean like actual in-your-brain kind of chemistry. The way he was telling it, Cupid's got nothing to do with it.
Feel a little woozy, sort of weak in the knee. It's got me wondering, is this love that I'm feeling? The science man says, you got it all wrong. It isn't love that's making your heart beat so strong. It's a genetic condition, a predisposition. When that woman walks over your way, your response is determined by your DNA. Evolution will decide if she turns you on. It's as predictable as counting the toes on your feet. It's a statistical certainty your heart skips a beat. It isn't love that you're feeling, it's really just a chemical bond. Oh yeah, it's really just a chemical bond. Oh yeah, those ruby red lips looking so fine, they're just a marker, an external sign of a healthy condition of adequate nutrition. And the curves on your body are driving me wild, are telling me you're capable of having my child. Enhanced propagation of the human population. And that dry sense of humor that's blowing my mind means your intellect will get us out of a bind. Escape a fire or a saber-toothed tiger. Oh yeah. Can this be love this way I feel? Conditioning makes the emotion so real. But now I understand.
understand. History's gone. The chain reaction when our eyes meet, it's a synaptic connection. The circuit's completed. Is it love that we're feeling? It's really just a chemical bond. Oh, yeah. It's really just a chemical bond. Oh, yeah. It's just a chemical bond.
Ain't nothing like it. It really, really puts it all into perspective, thinking about how long all them little lights had to take to travel all the way to the back of your eyeballs and into your brain. Anyway, I was fast asleep one night when this whole world turned upside down.
An angel appeared in a holy vision. Stood by my bedside, the shivering light. Spoke my name, told me my mission. I could not believe I was hearing him right, as he said, go, my son, go. Always go to Blessing May's Pie and Coffee Shop before you go to Starbucks or IHOP. Go to Blessing May's Coffee Shop before you go to IHOP. You help to keep them open. I'm worried that their sales will drop from the stiff competition from the national conglomerates serving up waffles around the clock and half-calf lattes on every block and trying to make you think you're cool all while playing you for the fool. Charging you $5 for for a cup of joe. Now you go, he said to me with light around his face. You go first to that age old place, to that old wooden door that you have to close behind you, to the wide board wooden floor worn down soft, to where they're serving up happiness by the slice and the very best coffee at any price. And you know that those smiles they show are never fake. And sure, there's times those other shops or stops you'll have to make, but pack your bags and go today to see those good folks and blessed me before they fade away. And now, for the first time since I started traveling with this Rainsong, really now, for the first time in my whole life, I have a place to be, a destination, maybe even a destiny. I really have no idea, but things are definitely going to change. So, like I said, Angel says, go. I say, yes, sir, right away, sir. And while it's not my custom to make any disparaging remarks about angelical messengers or nothing, I do have a bit of a bone to pick about this particular messenger and this particular message. Because while he was quite specific about the establishment I was to patronize, Blessie May's Pine Coffee Shop, that was crystal clear. And if I didn't hear it that first night, I sure caught it every night since, because he's invaded my dreams to say it all over again. And while he was quite specific about the coffee shop I was to visit, he never bothered mentioning the geographical location of this here coffee shop. Not a town, state, train line, time zone, nothing. Sure would have made my life a whole lot simpler to have had some small clue about where to look for this little needle in the haystack. So, I started asking folks, lots of folks, pretty much everybody I came across. Excuse me, sir. You happen to know where I might find Blessie May's Pine Coffee Shop? Sorry, Bobby, man. You ever heard of Blessie May? She sells pies and coffees in her shop. You know of a coffee shop that sells pies made by Blessie May? Somebody, anybody, you know Blessie May? I gotta find you, Blessie May! Got to be so I sounded like one of the crazy folks had some bugger on the butt about something or they just can't get off it. Between asking everybody all day long about Blessie May's Pine Coffee Shop and being badgered by Mr. Insistent Angel all night long, I was strung out and certifiable for sure. That was until 3 days ago. I'm walking through doing my usual inquisition march through the train, asking every single person in every car about this Blessie May's Pine Coffee Shop, when I step into the cafe car and hear a familiar voice.
Why, son, you look like you could do with a piece of my wife's world-famous coffee cake.
It was old Grizzly, but I didn't even recognize him, so I just snapped, coffee cake? I don't need no coffee cake. I need pie hot cake. More specifically, pie from Blessie May's Pine Coffee Shop. I don't suppose you ever heard of it. And just started walking away.
Heard of it? Why, I never miss a chance to visit when I'm running the Crescent Line down in Orleans. It's a decent haul off the line. Gotta hop on a bus in Tuscaloosa, and then you gotta walk a spell to get there. Town in the middle of nowhere. Little speck of a town. Get it, Bend, Alabama. But I'm telling you, it is worth the effort. Best peach pie I ever had. And I've sampled more than my fair share, I can assure you, son.
Once what he was saying sunk in, I gave old Grizzly the biggest bear hug I could muster and did enjoy a piece or two of his wife's world-famous coffee cake.
Then I got him to tell me exactly how to find this place, and we mapped out a plan to get me there as soon as physically possible. I was way out on the Empire Building line near Fargo, North Dakota at that point, so it took me a while to make it to this point. Then, you know, all the conductors seemed to know that my journey was going through a change, because they all seemed to want to shake my hand and offer me some encouraging words. Everything all right over there? Even that old coot with the hoot-out eyes wished me luck. It was the first time any of them paid more attention to me than to Ms. Rainsong. Then last night, when I got to Atlanta, I stopped in for a shower so I could sleep on a real bed. Woke to a knock the next morning from some of the fellas. The conductor hands me a pen and says I got a sign for Ms. Rainsong. I say, well, sure, where have I signed? He points to Ms. Rainsong. I wasn't sure at first, but then I understood I was supposed to sign her. So I looked around a while, found a nice spot, right up where she rubs up against my heart, and signed her. Well, the pen didn't seem to work. Station master said it was fine. Then he hands me an envelope saying the boys took up a collection to help me get started on the next leg of my journey. Then, one of the fellas hands me my old clothes back, all folded up and laundered, or at least as laundered as they could get them. I'm kind of surprised they didn't just burn them. It felt mighty strange pulling on these old jeans and boots again. I felt like such a different soul from the man I was in that past life. It was like I was pulling on the skin of a stranger. A stranger I did not care to know. But after a while, I realized I was still the same man. Definitely a changed man, but not a man defined by my clothes or by the transgressions of my past. I'm just a traveler on a journey. Only now, I know how to share that journey with another. That other happened to be a guitar, an amazing, beautiful soul in her own right. A soul I will forever be grateful for having met. I'm grateful for all y'all, too. Let me share our story. I guess it is kind of an amazing tale when you put it all together like this. Well, I guess it's time. Breaks my heart to even say it, but it's time. You might mean this great song, sharing one last song before I go.
Leave you.
finish too fast. You find yourself searching for something to make feelings last. Listening for magical meanings and unlock the mysteries within. As if when you find out the secret, the answers unfold and life can begin. But you can't force a moment, they won't be cajoled. No elusive elixir makes moments unfold. But when your soul is at peace and you're looking away, the magic will find you, the moment will stay. You can see it inside your one true love's eyes. In a stranger's good morning, a baby's soft cries. You never can know when the moment will show. When your heart's ready, the moments will flow. So forget your agenda, drop your guard, let go and surrender. It's really not hard, simply set yourself free and fear flies away.
We all love this way.
take turns coming up here and just standing there. And just be that. That would be a great way to live life, huh? Oh, so it's like I said in the program for having a. It takes a surprising amount of people to do a one-man show, you know. And I want to make sure that we recognize our amazing sound guy. I'll tell you what, we had a tech rehearsal yesterday. It was a total disaster. And I don't know if you've seen Shakespeare in Love, but you know the whole thing about it's a mystery, how it's all come together again. It was that in spades. Nothing was working. I don't know how did this turn out? Could you see the signatures and stuff? You know, people have been going on this journey and what's that?
Oh boy.
Oh yeah, the boy. Yes, there's the boy. And then Terry called and did our lights and just the amazing Ann saw the workshop version of this in my house. We had 12 people. And how many people were at that? I know a couple of people came back. So Seth, Ann, there we go. Yeah, it was just, you know, this thing has been rattling around in my head for over 8 years. And as you saw in the program, some of the songs are more than 20 years old. And I tend to write these sort of dramatic songs, right? And they don't always fit in a bar. And so just having a vehicle for a singer-songwriter to be able to share their music, and I said in the program, my wildest kind of imagination is that this becomes like Willie Loman from Death of a Salesman. You know, every singer-songwriter wants to be Traveler someday and put their songs in the middle of this show. Wouldn't that be cool if every time when you came to it, you didn't know exactly what story was going to be told, but it was the same story over and over? I do have one last thing I want to do before I let you guys go. My wife. My son, too. She gets automatic sainthood now because she has had to listen to me do this over and over and over and obsessed about this show in the middle of having a day job trying to get our son out of the house someday and dealing with water leaks and everything. So. And
thank you.